thank you all for coming, for giving up your Wednesday evening to be here. Welcome to CSEP's seventh event of the term, Econophysics, the Future of Economics. We're delighted to have two expert speakers to give their views on this very interesting topic. So just for the overall format, each speaker will talk for between 20 minutes and half an hour, followed by a discussion for about another 30 minutes. Please do ask questions. We want to be a nice, lively, engaging event. So our first speaker is Dr. Tobias Preis. He's Associate Professor of Behavioral Science at the Warwick Business School. He also has a PhD in Theoretical Physics and is the author of more than 30 scientific publications. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Tobias.
Thank you very much for the nice introduction, and thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here today and to talk about our recent work in this wider field. So first of all, I possibly should explain what my trajectory is. So we have just heard I did some physics in the past, so theoretical physics, used agent-based models in order to try and understand herding processes in financial markets. And yeah, with this initial link between physics, so using methods from complexity science, from actually modeling how matter behaves, and complexity methods in different parts of subfields within physics, more and more people started to look into possibilities to apply this in a financial or economic context. And that's probably the reason why I'm here today. So that's the area where I started off, so to say. So today I work at Warwick Business School. I'm an associate professor for behavioral science and finance, and I direct the data science lab over there. And data science actually already brings me to the wider area where basically I think econophysics, how it started, is actually growing or developing too. Because if you think about the question how, or in which way physicists became interested in modeling financial markets and economical processes in general, then this had something to do with the methods, with the toolbox which they had available. But to some extent also, some crucial change which happened in the worldwide markets at that point in time. And this was the availability of data. So when in the 1990s electronic trading platforms emerged and replaced systems where people were interacting with each other, telling to buy or sell a certain stock in a verbal way, so to say, then a vast amount of data just became immediately accessible because central exchange places started to record this information, and some smart physicists, in particular physicists working with Gene Stanley, who actually created this name, Econophysics, back many, many years ago, they got hold of these data sets and tried to extract, based on data, empirical laws, how markets, or particular fluctuations in markets, how they can be described. So what then happened, and what actually the trajectory of many people in that field was over time, is that now we are actually facing another transition, and that's something in the next 20 minutes or so I want to talk about. The things we are talking about today is using data from lots of different sources, not only financial markets, in order to even go one step up in terms of broadness, quantifying human behavior, not only in a financial and economic context, but also how humans behave in general. And this is now possible because something quite dramatic changed over the last decade. So now we are leaving the 1990s. It is actually the fact that all of us, we are now interacting with large technological devices, systems like the internet as a whole, and services like Google, Twitter, social networks, and so on and so forth in particular. So this is opening up a completely different and very diverse source of information, which allows us to quantify human behavior in a financial and economic context, but also go beyond and actually quantify behavior which wasn't possible to quantify before. And so I would like to share with you in the next few minutes a few recent examples of our lab's work in exactly this field. And I would like to start with showing you one of these examples or data sets we are working with on a day-to-day basis. So this world map is just created by taking 35 million photos, which users of the internet photo sharing website Flickr have taken during the year 2014, uploaded to the website, and these were the photos, the subset of photos which contained GPS information, which is extractable and can be used for analysis. I will show you an example where we actually use this in terms of matching official statistics in the UK later on. So, but let me start with probably one very fascinating data set, and this is the information on what people are searching for online. So never before have we had an opportunity to study what people are interested in at a global scale. So Google allows us to get access to time series via a website called Google Trends, which gives us information on a weekly basis for most of the keywords on what people have been searching on over time. And this is as diverse as you can imagine. So you can put in any keyword you're interested in. And in particular, linking it with financial markets, we asked the questions we were extremely interested in, whether we see behavior in search behavior which can explain fluctuations we see in the marketplace, on the other hand. So there's an entire stream of research. I don't have the time to go into too much detail here today. So it started in 2009 when we actually linked search volume on company names to how many stocks are shared at NYSE and so on and so forth. But at some point we got interested in the question, can we actually say something about subsequent price fluctuations in the markets using this new type of information available online? And in a very brief case study, which I want to tell you now, we used the information on how often people search for a particular topic or keyword in a particular week. And we are not necessarily interested in the level, the absolute number of people searching for something. That's also something technically Google doesn't share with us, because it's only an activity index. It's normalized to an artificial maximum, and Google wants to hide what is the actual number of people searching for something for advertisement reasons and so on and so forth. And so we are interested mainly in the change. So what is the change in how many people are interested in a certain subject? So, like in this example, we find that people have searched for a particular keyword in the current week less frequently than the mean value, the average value of previous weeks. In this example shown here, the average of 3 weeks. We have to make a decision. We want to build a hypothetical trading strategy feeding in information from Google. So we want to build a very simple one, so we have to make a decision. So if there are less people, less searches recorded in the current week compared to previous weeks, we actually take this as a positive sign. That's an assumption, or was at that point in time an assumption. And for that reason, we actually trigger hypothetically a buy transaction. So we buy the market, in this case the Dow Jones Industrial Average, at the beginning of the coming week, in order to ensure that there is no overlap between the signal recorded, so search volume gets updated over the weekend, Pacific time, between Saturday and Sunday, and then we act in the markets at the closing price on the following Monday. So we buy the Dow Jones Industrial Average at the beginning of week T plus one, and we keep this position for exactly 1 week, and then we sell again. So we make a profit if the market goes up, otherwise we lose. So obviously the opposite effect could happen, so we could actually register more surges in the current week compared to previous weeks. And then we take this as a sign of concern, so we interpret this in a way that we open a short position in the market, so we sell short the Dow Jones Industrial Average at the beginning of the coming week and keep this position for 1 week and buy the index back 1 week later. Very simple strategy. Let me show you a few examples when we implemented this strategy on a weekly basis, going back to the beginning of 2004. So that's the earliest possible time for which you can get data from Google. And then we implemented this. So over time, you see the cumulative profit and loss of this strategy. This strategy means how often people have searched for just a very random term, culture. And these were searches generated in the US. So how many people in the US with US IP addresses have searched for the term culture? You see the fluctuations. You clearly see that we only have 5% more after we have carried out lots of transactions over this time period until February 2011. 5% is not really something we should be very excited about. And in particular, not very excited about when we compare this one with one common and simple benchmark strategy, which is the buy and hold strategy, which results in 16% over the same time period. 5%, 16%, both of these values are not very exciting, in particular when we take into account that we have faced certain fluctuations over this time period, right? I mean, the index went down quite dramatically over the during the financial market crisis, as shown there in 2008, 2009. And so when you compare this with typical fluctuations, which we here visualize by the plus minus one standard deviation boundaries, which we realized by just constructing 10,000 different portfolios, and each of these portfolios were trading in a completely random manner, then we find that both of these values stay very much within this band of plus minus one standard deviation. This was one example we looked at. Let me show you another example with exactly the same strategy. We used as an input the number of searches carried out for the term debt. So that's a slightly different picture we see. So we end up with 326% over this time period, with a very significant outperformance during the years of the financial market crisis. And so that's something, I mean, not the number is interesting, but the fact that we actually outperform over this time period by something like plus three standard deviations, the market. So this is obviously something which we have to consider carefully, because in this point in time, I'm cheating. I'm showing you the best result out of a number of keywords we have looked at. In fact, we looked at 98 different keywords we analyzed. And that, as I mentioned, was the best one. Culture was something which was more or less located in the middle here towards the right. And the question we wanted to ask in this initial study, in this case study, was, can we actually extract some features which can answer the question what a keyword makes successful? So we constructed the set of 98 keywords in a way that we put together some financially rated keywords, some non-financially rated keywords. When we look at the result of these different keywords, then we were actually puzzled by the fact that the more financially related ones tended to be on the left side of the spectrum, rather than actually the more randomly put together keywords tended to be or stayed very close to the flat line, zero. So we wanted to quantify this. Can we actually find some evidence that this intuition might be the case? So we had to quantify to which extent a keyword is financially related. And in order to do this, we came up with a measure by counting the occurrences of these individual words, culture, debt, restaurant, color, and so on and so forth, and counted how often these words were used historically in the Financial Times, because obviously the Financial Times writes about financial subjects. And we had to normalize it by the fact that also general keywords like the, and so on and so forth were used, are used in general literature quite prominently, as in the Financial Times. And so we are building this ratio. What we find in this case study is that the results over all these years and all these keywords are significantly correlated with what we came up with in terms of an indicator for financial relevance. So that's a snapshot of this stream of research. We looked at different other data sources. We looked at Wikipedia, how often people view Wikipedia pages relating to financial topics. We looked at how often people search for company names, how often they actually look up company articles on Wikipedia. We find that in individual years this results holds, and so on and so forth. And at some point we turned this question around and tried to find out from an entire possible space of search volume topics and access topics to which extent individual subsets are leading markets 1 week later, leading market behavior 1 week later. So we are not claiming at all that these very simple patterns stay or remain significant in the near future for very simple reasons. I mean, behavior in the financial markets is extremely special. It's changing over time, but there's also a huge incentive to change and to take into account information you know about the markets. So let me bring you a second example where we use these new types of data sets similar to the financial markets, where basically this information became accessible in order to quantify human behavior in the real world. And this is an example, actually a PhD student of ours published with us this year, where he asked an age-old question, basically. It's the question, how many people are in a certain area? So how many people are, for example, protesting? The police is coming up with estimates for these problems. And also here, it's not search volume, it's a completely different new type of information, and that's mobile phone activity, where we had access to a very special data set in the city of Milan. This was over a 10-week period. We had access for individual subcells, 235 meters squared in 10-minute intervals. And you can see here an example of this activity. And we had to calibrate this information to how many people are actually in the real world because we wanted to quantify crowd size. And what we found, what we used for this in the end, was an example for which we historically or afterwards definitely know how many people have been there. And this was a football stadium, San Siro, the local stadium in Milan, where, for example, on that day, the two local teams played against each other. You can see the activity, mobile phone activity during the day, and in particular these two bars which mark the two halves of the game, the build-up when people arrive at the stadium, and so on and so forth. So, and when we look at the information, how many tickets got sold in the real world, in reality, and how many people went through the barrier, here shown as these peaks at the bottom, in this bottom panel, then you find that the activity on these human activity layers retrieved from mobile phone activity, so calls and SMS, how many phones are connected to the internet, opening connections, closing connections, and so on and so forth. This is closely related to the patterns we find in terms of how many tickets have been sold. If we look at the correlation, if we build very simple regressions, then we find there's a very close match between all three of these different types of data sets. In particular, I note that Twitter activity, so this means in this case how many geolocalized tweets have been sent from the stadium of Milan in that particular time period, is something which is publicly available compared to activity which comes from mobile phone providers, which obviously require certain negotiation in order to access these data sets. As a brief note, to basically leave this example behind us, but a brief note before that actually internet activity seems to be the best indicator out of these three indicators, which intuitively makes sense if we think about the question how we use our mobile devices. So calls and SMS require our active attention. We make our call, we make a call, we call a friend for a chat, while internet activity, opened connections, maintained and closed connections, is something which happens in the background just by carrying our phone around. And so it makes sense that we find that this is the best indicator in this example. So a third example, bringing us back to the type of big data, type of Flickr photos I have shown you before. And this is a question where we make use of the fact that data in this online domain is much quicker available than information maybe gathered in the real world. So we worked with a data set which is originally collected by the Office for National Statistics here in the UK, and they are tasked with putting together something which is called the International Passenger Survey, sending humans to airports, asking arriving passengers, where have you been over the past 12 months or so, and where are you going to, and so on and so forth. And this information is aggregated, which takes a certain amount of time, and that's the crucial step. And with a certain delay only, it is accessible to authorities how many people from individual countries have visited the UK. So what we did in brief is we used 140 million Flickr photos with GPS information in order to reconstruct individual trajectories of users traveling around the globe. So we used the fact that they stayed in a certain country, and when they took the first photo in the UK, then we used this as indicator that they crossed the boundary. We counted this as one visit by this user trajectory, so to say. And by analyzing this for 28 countries, for the 28 countries for which also the Office for National Statistics aggregates this information, we were able to match closely with just like a square of 0.86 the information which they collect in a much slower fashion. So data on photos people are uploading to a photo sharing website might actually give us some clue on where official statistics are going to in terms of up or down, but in a much quicker fashion. So it can actually help us to close reporting lags. And this brings me to my last and final example, which is actually one of the first examples. So if you think about econophysics from moving from quantifying financial market with lots of data to a human world where you basically can try lots of different data sources in order to understand and measure human behavior, there was at more or less at this intermediate stage an effort by Google engineers, so coming back to Google search data, to team up with the Centers for Disease Control in Atlanta in the US, who also faced and still face a reporting lag issue. And this relates to the flu, to the number of flu cases in the US. So that what they are that is what they are tasked to do on a weekly basis. They have to get information from a network of doctors all over the US, and they are asking them how many influenza-like illness patients they have seen over this period. And then they aggregate this information, put it together on a state and countrywide level, and then 2 weeks only later, they have the information on how many people in the US had the flu. So they were wondering whether they can use additional information on how many people search for certain topics in order to close this reporting gap a little bit. So this is the point in time when Google engineers turned up and in 2008, 2009, used this time series of influenza-like illness patients in order to correlate this in a brute force fashion with all possible search terms which Google had in their database at that point in time. What they found is that the most correlated ones, in fact, at that point in time, were keywords which related to flu symptoms. So they thought this was great. They published a paper in Nature, this team, and it got rolled out as a service, which later on was called Google Flu Trends, and authorities around the globe started to use this in order to measure a little bit better and quicker how many people have the flu. So at some point, there was a problem, and this is a problem which is quite fundamental and goes beyond the flu. And so that's the reason why I like this example, because it's the same in the financial markets, it's the same whatever type of behavior we are looking at. So behavior is changing. And so what happened at some point is that Google got it wrong. And they got it wrong quite dramatically using this very simple method on how many people are searching for flu symptoms and using this as an input for the number of flu cases in the real world. So in fact, you can see this red curve almost twice as many people are considered to have the flu compared to the actual number of people in the real world having the flu. So what happened? So there were all sorts of reasons quoted for this behavior, for this mismatch. One leading one is that there were news reports issued about the new stem of the flu and H1N1. There were other types of problems which at some point in time we need to consider, right? I mean, search volume is also something which is not constant due to changes in human behavior, but also in the way how this information gets recorded and also the way how this information is displayed over time. Google is changing the search algorithm, for example. It's displaying information in a different format and way. In particular, in the US, you find little small info boxes if you type in certain specific topical search terms. And so all these things are influencing the way we have access to these types of data sets. So this was an outcry in this wider field, which people consider to name computational social science or data science. And the problem was that this example, which became very famous in the first place, actually also triggered a lot of problems. And people already thought that this might be the end of using this type of information in order to quantify human behavior. So what happened then? A number of people around the world, including my colleague Susie Mode and I, looked at, is it really the end? I mean, can we actually fix this, given what we know about human behavior, given what we know about the problem in question? And if you think about what Google did, they just used a very simple correlation. They used the most correlated search terms, and then they assumed that's the information you can use over time. You can just go along and feed in this information. So we obviously can think about the problem that human behavior might change. And we also can think about a problem that, or to some extent it's an advantage, that the two weeks delayed information, how many people had the flu 2 weeks before, that's something we always know. That's the delayed information about the system itself. So can we put all of this together? And that's actually the question we asked. And we found that when we include the past information 2 weeks ago and build a very simple model. If you're familiar with the Riemann models, just a baseline model uses using the past, the lagged information about the system itself, and using as an external regressor what Google came up with as search from volume relevant to Google flu searches, then we find that we can improve this underlying baseline system, baseline model, which just uses the delayed past influenza cases. But it's not an advantage which is really tremendous. There's one second step needed, and this is related to the change over time. So we have seen that, for example, externally triggered events like a new stem of the flu can actually change this relationship. And so the idea we came up with is actually that we need to recalibrate what we get from the online world and how this information reflects the fraction of people being ill in the real world. So in fact, what we did in this Riemann model with external regressor is that we had a sliding window which was running through this time series, and basically at every point in time relearning this relationship between what search volume actually means for the number of cases in the real world. So with this, in brief, we can reduce the mean absolute error of this forecasting problem by 16% to 53%. But crucially, we have actually found a way to link in a dynamic fashion, in an adaptive fashion, what people are searching for online and how this relates to a real-world problem which is delayed. So with these few examples, I wanted to highlight were actually what physicists started to do maybe 20 years ago, roughly, or more, in terms of using data which became accessible in terms of financial markets becoming electronic trading platforms, allowing them to quantify all possible transactions, looking at distributional properties of financial markets, basically using their empirical insights, is something which continues by different data sources coming up, quantifying not only trading, but different aspects of human behavior, of our everyday human behavior, which allows us to, in some cases, measuring the world a little bit quicker than which was previously possible, where this might matter, for example, for official statistics, which are delayed by design, by basically the way how it gets aggregated. And if we know a little better what the state of the system, the state of the world is right now, then in some cases, this might allow us to predict a little bit better what at least a large group of people might do in the near future. And with this, I would like to close and thank you.
Thank you very much for that talk. So now I'll introduce our second speaker, Dr. Christophe Schinckus. He is a lecturer in finance at the School of Business at Leicester University. He is also completing his second PhD on the philosophy of science here in Cambridge. He's the author of numerous papers on econophysics and is currently writing a book on the subject. Please join me in welcoming him.
Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank you, the Society, for having invited me. I'm delighted to be here with you tonight in order to talk about econophysics and in order to make the link with what Tobias was talking about. That's very interesting, actually, because I will focus not on the same kind of econophysics. You talk and you explain very clearly the fact that econophysics, we have two phases. So we have at the beginning econophysics dealing with financial data, and then now we have this new way of dealing with data in econophysics, and you talked about that. Me, I will focus more on the original econophysics. I mean, how this field emerged, and basically this presentation is based on two pieces of research, and actually I will be very reflexive and methodological, so I will be a little bit boring, actually, because I will not present results. I will not present a model or something like that. I will talk about what econophysicists are doing and to what extent is different to what we are doing in finance, for example. And what is different and to what extent econophysics could contribute to finance, because we also use statistics in finance. So what's the difference? And moreover, it's a very old story, the link between economics and physics. So it's a more reflexive story that I would like to talk about tonight. So this is the plan. It's a little bit old school, sorry, probably the French influence. So the plan of the presentation, I plan to talk to structure this presentation into three parts: the history of econophysics, quickly, and then I will talk about current econophysics. What I mean by current econophysics, I mean statistical econophysics. So exactly the first, what you said before, the beginning of econophysics, because this econophysics dealing with financial data, this literature is still growing. So this is the mainstream in econophysics, if we could use this word for econophysics. So this is what I plan to talk about, and future of econophysics. So to what extent that would be possible, for example, to have a common framework between financial economics and econophysics. So that means that I plan to talk more here about financial economics and the origin of econophysics. And very quickly, as you know, physics has been used as a reference in the producing of knowledge, in the production of knowledge in economics. And we could mention very quickly three movements. The first movement was at the beginning of the economics, in the second part of the 19th century, when the economics emerged, and at that time economists, they tried to imitate the way of producing knowledge. They tried to imitate physicists, actually, in the way of producing knowledge by using concepts coming from physics. The second movement is at the turn of the 20th century, and the influence of quantum physics on economics, because quantum physics at that time suggested the development of a more interdeterministic framework and tools in economics. So this is the two first movements, and actually these two movements are very well documented in the existing literature. The third movement, we could associate this third movement with the development of econophysics in the 90s. So econophysics, basically, what's this? It's the quantitative approach using ideas and models coming from statistical physics. This is the original definition that we can find in Mantegna and Stanley. Basically, here I give you some key informations, key points that we usually associate with econophysics. So, econophysics is not only an importation of physics concepts, Because we did it, we observed that in the past with Black and Scholes models, for example, in finance. Black was physicist, and we have a lot of examples of physicists working in finance. But the difference with this movement is the fact that in the past, physicists, they tried to translate their knowledge into financial framework. But here, econophysicists, they don't try to translate their knowledge. There is no translation. Actually, they come with their concepts and they apply their knowledge, but they don't try to give an economic meaning to the data they will use, for example. I will talk about that more later. Importance of instability versus equilibrium in economics. I will give you some words more after. Data-driven models, so Tobias was emphasizing this point, in opposition with the classical axiomatic approach in mainstream economics. And financial markets has complex systems, and the importance of emergent properties, scales, invariance, and so on. So this is the key characteristics usually associated with econophysics. So what I plan to do now is to talk a little bit about what is econophysics and what is the difference with financial economics. I mean econometrics, I mean statistics that we are used, that we are very familiar in finance, for example. So here you have a quick visual definition of econophysics. So as you can see, econophysics is by essence a very interdisciplinary perspective. A very interdisciplinary field, sorry. Because here you can see that econophysics is at the interface of different fields, complex system theory, computational physics, and economics and finance. So my question is, I'm interested here, I'm not here as a financial economist, even if I am. I'm here as a philosopher of science because I'm working on this PhD in philosophy of science. And I try to understand, okay, to what extent econophysics is different from financial economics? And is it useful or not to deal with this knowledge? And is it possible to have a common framework between these two fields? Because at the end of the day, they have different background, econophysicists and financial economists, but they claim to do the same. They claim to study the same reality. So what's the difference? This is my main question. Before talking about that, maybe it's interesting to emphasize the fact that econophysics did not pop up from nowhere. As you can guess, we had a specific context, and here I just mentioned some contextual factors which contributed to the emergence of econophysics. First of all, and you mentioned it, the importance of computers. In the 80s, the personal computers were booming, and we used more and more computers in science. That means that we were able to record more and more data. So that means the number of databases were increasing. So that means that we have a huge source of information. And moreover, this kind of, the computers can also open some doors for simulation. And of course, this is agent-based modeling. And this is what I mean by simulation here. So that's important to keep that in mind, because in order to do econophysics, you need to have a lot of data. So that's important to emphasize this point. The second point is also related to the context, the scientific context in the 80s. Actually, in the 80s, we had a lot of criticism related to the too narrow-minded science, which was focused on the Cold War issues. And a lot of people, they were calling for a more interdisciplinary science. And then this is at that period that we had the Santa Fe Institute. This institute has been created in 1944 by physicists, but with the purpose, with the objective to do an interdisciplinary research. So physicists, they invited people from different disciplinary horizons. So that's very important, because this place was the perfect place in order to initiate the computational methods that we can find today in econophysics. I mean patterns, statistical patterns. When you have a lot of data and you try to identify some macro statistical patterns, this is what I mean by patterns. Webs, that means the study, the analysis of networks and how some networks can appear. So that means basically agent-based modeling. And cycles, at that time it was related to chaos theories, but this literature progressively disappeared in the Santa Fe studies. Okay, so that means that here, as I told you, what I plan to do here is to focus on this specific literature. That means that you have the Santa Fe Institute. This is the place where they developed a three computational approaches. And one of them will become econophysics. One of them, I mean, patterns. All works related to patterns. So what I mean by patterns, I mean the identification of statistical macro regularities in the evolution of complex systems. And progressively, this theme has become an independent area of knowledge called econophysics. This is the beginning of econophysics. So they had a lot of data related to financial markets, thanks to computers, databases, and so on. And then physicists tried to identify some macro patterns there. So officially, the birth of econophysics is usually associated with the publication of Mantegna and Stanley. They are the fathers of this field. And actually, what they try to do, basically, econophysicists, originally, what they try to do, they try to observe, they try to characterize the occurrence of extreme variation on the financial markets, because this is the major puzzles of financial economics. How we can explain the occurrence of extreme values on the financial markets. So at the beginning, the birth of econophysics is directly related to the characterization of extreme value, the occurrence of extreme value. And in order to capture this reality, they will compare the occurrence of extreme variations on financial market with occurrence of volcano eruptions and extreme phenomena in physics. Both observation can statistically be described through power law, a very specific statistical framework. However, statistical frameworks are nothing new in economics and finance because, well, it's in economics everybody knows that Pareto in 1897, he observed a specific statistical pattern, a specific linearity in the repartition of wealth in the population. And he observed this kind of power law. So that means that the concept of power law is nothing new in finance and economics because we are used to use it actually, but not necessarily in financial markets. And I'm going to explain why. We don't use it in financial market. We use it in order to characterize the size of the cities, the number of words in the text and this kind of stuff. So we can find some works in economics about the size of cities and this kind of stuff, but not related to the characterization of extreme values in finance for a very specific point that I will mention just after. So that means that according to econophysicists, the fact that we can observe the same kind of statistical patterns in different unrelated phenomena, that means that we have a kind of universality of power law. And this kind of patterns will become very important in econophysics. And actually, even if the literature in econophysics is very fragmented, I think that I could say that, and I did a bibliometric analysis in order to check that. And actually, the word and the theme of power law is probably a hardcore element, an element of the hardcore of econophysics, for sure, in a sense that the power law is very important in econophysics, I mean statistical econophysics. And the point is, okay, that's interesting to see that in a lot of different phenomena, we can observe the same linear relationship. Like, for example, here are the magnitude of earthquakes, the citation of scientific papers, the copy of books sold in the USA, and this kind of stuff. So that means that for econophysicists, this kind of pattern appears to be universal. And some physicists begin to consider that this linearity maybe could be a law of nature. Okay, so that's you got the point. That means that econophysicists, they try to see in financial data the emergence of a macro statistical pattern. Okay, and if they are able to see the same kind of patterns, they will be very happy with that, because then that means that there is a kind of universality in the data. So econophysics, nothing new. Well, the point is that I think it's interesting to mention some differences, because when I talk with economists, they say that, okay, look, econophysics, we are not very interested in that because it's a pale copy of econometrics. We try to describe from a statistical point of view the evolution of financial markets by using econometrics. Moreover, in the emergence of econometrics, in the 30s, we also have a lot of physicists who developed this this field. So that means that at the end of the day, econophysics is considered sometimes by economists as a pale copy of econometrics. However, I think it's important to mention that it's not the same. Because first of all, I mean, there is a difference between econometrics and econophysics. First of all, from an historical institutional point of view, what Cole's commission they did by creating econometrics, it's not what the Santa Fe Institute did when they created the computational techniques which give econophysics. In a sense that the objective of the Cole Commission was to formalize and axiomatize the Walserian general equilibrium theory. So that means they focus on axiomatization and formalization. In contrast, the Santa Fe Institute, they want to develop a more interdisciplinary science based on evolutionary process in which you don't have axiomatization, because axiomatization is considered by physicists in the Santa Fe Institute as too abstract, too far from reality. So that means that from this point of view, for sure, I mean, historically speaking, they don't have the same objective. So first of all, but I think the most important is the methodological aspect. Here, what I'm going to say is a caricature, okay? It's a caricature of econophysics and it's a caricature of econometrics. But what I want to emphasize is the intuitions. It's the intuitions between the two fields. Because I know that it's much more, you can find a lot of counterexamples to what I'm saying now, for sure, in econophysics and in econometrics. But if you check the mainstream of the literature, I mean the basic stuff, this is what we can say. So again, it's a caricature, but I use this caricature as a kind of, you know, as a starting point for the interaction, okay? So what is the difference between econophysics and econometrics from a methodological point of view? I would say that the difference refers to the way of dealing with extreme values, again. In econometrics, we use, I mean, if we think about harsh models, we develop specific statistical techniques in a Gaussian framework or an improved Gaussian framework. And that means we have the main trend is Gaussian. And then we will try to characterize the occurrence of extreme value by using another distribution. This is the conditional, unconditional approach of econometrics. So you have the unconditional distribution related to the major trend, I mean Gaussian framework, and then you have the conditional distribution related to the corrective part of the process in order to capture the extreme value. So this is, roughly speaking, what we do in basic econometrics, okay? I know that there are some counterexamples, but it's just to give you, to fix the point in order to give you the intuition. Okay, so what about econophysics then? And basically in econophysics then people, they don't like the idea of conditional, unconditional. They will only use an unconditional distribution because they will say, look, you have the data, so follow the data. You have to take the data as the data are. You don't have to use a corrective perspective, because if you use conditional, unconditional approach, that means that in the conditional approach, you can develop ad hoc description. So that means that you can use the process, the statistical process you want in order to characterize the extreme values. But econophysicists, they are more data-driven. They will say, I will follow the data as given by the market, by the financial market. So from a methodological point of view, I would say that this is the major difference if you check the literature. And that's very interesting to see that when you have people in finance, people in physics, when they talk together, they claim to do the same thing. They use the same words, like Levy process, whatever, but they don't put the same content to these words. And as you know, people in finance, they have a very good idea of themselves, and people in physics, they have a very good idea of themselves. So it's very difficult to find a talk between them. And that's very interesting to see how it's difficult to have a dialogue between these two communities. Why? Because they claim to do the same thing, they use the same kind of data, and they use the same statistics. But they don't implement these statistics in the same way. Again, here it's just intuition that I give you, okay? The point is, and this is a good question that a lot of physicists ask me. when I talk with physicists, I said that, okay, some of them, they ask me, why the Gaussian framework, we can see the Gaussian framework in very often in the literature in finance. Maybe people in finance are stupid, that they are not able to see that the market is not Gaussian. Of course, people in finance, they are not stupid. They know that the market is not Gaussian. So why they keep it? So why they keep the Gaussian framework? It's very difficult to explain that. But roughly speaking, I could say that there are two reasons. Historical reason, the Gaussian framework directly contributed to the scientificization of financial economics when this field emerged in the 60s. This is the first point. That means that all basic models and knowledge in finance is based on Gaussian. Of course, not only, but all textbooks are based on that. So that means that a textbook is the good indicator of what is the basic knowledge. So that's the point, historical reason. We don't want to delete the origin of our discipline. First point. The second point is ethical reason. Some authors, they say that there are some ethical reasons to the fact that the Gaussian framework is very important, because actually, as you know, the Gaussian distribution is a symmetric distribution. That means that you have the same chance to win or to lose money. That means that markets are fair. If markets are fair, you don't have to change something. So that means that in terms of authors, financial economists, they can say that, look, markets are fair. So I'm not dealing with gambling games or something like that. I'm dealing with a fair phenomenon. And from authorities, that could be also interesting to see the official speech and discourse of authorities, financial authorities, and to see to what extent it's related directly or indirectly to the Gaussian framework. It's very interesting to do it, because if the market is fair, for the authority it's good, because the best thing to do is to do nothing. So there are some ethical stuff there. So that means that financial economists, they have a specific ontology. They have a specific way of thinking the market. We cannot describe the market without thinking the market. Without having a specific way of thinking the market. And we can develop this point if you want, but I don't have time to do it now. So that's the point. So at the opposite, we could ask, okay, good. So I understand why you want to keep the Gaussian framework. Okay, good. But at the opposite, why you don't want to use, why financial economists, they don't use a power law, for example, like a Pareto law, Pareto distribution. Why? For a methodological reason. Some authors say that there is a methodological reason. This approach in econometrics, this distinction between conditional, unconditional approach in econometrics, would be related to the importance of the ceteris paribus assumption in economics. As you know, it's a very important assumption in economics. This is what we learned in first year in textbook. It's very important. And because of that would be, this approach, unconditional-conditional approach, would be directly related to the history of this ceteris paribus assumption in economics. First reason, we cannot forget that. This is what some authors emphasize. The other point is a technical reason. Because I have to mention Mandelbrot, I have to mention Fama, I have to mention Samuelson, this guy, in the 60s, they propose a description of the financial markets based on Pareto law. They propose that. However, it was not so easy to use this stable Levy process. Why? Because this kind of process, if I take the example of a Pareto law, they will imply an infinite, undetermined variance. And as you know, the variance is directly associated with the risk in finance. So that means that if you use this kind of statistical framework in order to describe the evolution of financial market, you will not be able to define the concept of risk. So how you will be able, for example, to develop a portfolio management then? So that's the, at that time, that was the case. And not the only case, because we also do not have statistical tests. No Gaussian statistical test in order to validate the emergence of a power law from when we check the data. I'm going to talk about that in a few minutes. So very quickly here, again, it's a pedagogical purpose with this table. It's a caricature of econometrics and econophysics. But because I take the example of power law and Arch models here, but what I wanted to emphasize is the conditional, unconditional versus unconditional approach. I wanted also to emphasize the fact that, yes, econophysicists, for them, they have a phenomenological approach of the financial markets. They want to describe the market as the market is. But in finance, we don't have a describing perspective. We have a corrective perspective with econometrics. We assume something, and we have a lot of debate in economics related to, you know, the assumption in econometrics, and even if, I mean, this is Avelmo and so on debates. So we have a corrective perspective. We have a way of thinking the market, and then we will try to capture the occurrence of extreme value. So that's a very important point, I think, between, this is a good point in order to make the distinction between econophysicists and econometricians. Even if some econometrician will say, no, I describe the market as well. Yes, indeed, but in a different way, by using a different methodology. This is what I want to emphasize here. Maybe another point is the short term, the opposition between short term and long term. I was talking with traders, and I was asking them, okay, do you use econophysics? And they say, no, I don't use it. I say, why? Because me, I'm working only in maximum 3 weeks. So I don't need this, the long-term perspective as we can have with power law and statistical framework. But again, I know that, for example, in econometrics, we use Hurst exponent in order to capture the long-term as well. And I know that here we also have some statistical tools in order to capture the short-term, but I just want to here to give you a quick overview of the mainstream, okay? Because I'm aware that it's a bit caricatural here, I know that. But we can talk if you want after. So, okay, good. So I hope you have the intuition in order to make an opposition between econophysics and econometrics very quickly. Historical distinction, methodological distinction. And also the reason for why the Gaussian is important in finance. Now, then you can ask, okay, to what extent econophysics is useful for finance? And that's a very good question. We talk a lot when we begin this. So I would like to mention contributions of econophysics from an econophysicist's point of view. And their point of view is the fact that, okay, look, we have we propose a data-driven approach. We will describe the market as the market is. So you have some quotation here. So we do not massage the data. So it's a very strong point of view. The same person. Current economics texts are not better than cartoons. Because what does it mean? That means that's exactly what I have mentioned before. I mean, this physicist just emphasized the fact that we in finance, we are used to think the market before describing the market. So that means we have something in mind before seeing the market. This is not what physicists are doing, because they are used to describe the reality as the reality is. It's a disciplinary perspective. So that's the point. And actually that's true. I mean, econophysicists, they have very strong argument in order to emphasize their contributions. And that's true. They have a lot of interesting tools. And Tobias was showing some of them. That's true. They have very good contributions. And here I just plan to mention very quickly two of them. The importance of the long term. And that's interesting here to mention that the underestimation of the long-term risk in finance could put a company into bankruptcy, of course. And actually, just a quotation in order to illustrate this point of view. And in econophysics, you have a lot of tools in order to capture this long-term perspective. So that means that we can find in the literature a lot of good contribution for pension funds, for example, or long-term management, portfolio management. In terms of financial crashes as well, econophysicists, they use a specific conceptual framework coming from self-criticality and so on, coming from physics. And by using that, they consider the financial markets as an evolving system, as a complex system, evolving into a configuration of fragile critical states. So that means that at the end of the day, you can make an analogy between the evolution of critical states and the crash. And some physicists developed this perspective. And that's very interesting to see that, from a phenomenological point of view, they are able to fit the data with their tools. And they created the Financial Crisis Observatory in the University of Zurich, so that they have contribution, for sure. Because if we are able to predict the financial crash, then we could manage. But I put a question mark, because in finance, actually, that's a very old question. When I was talking with physicists, they say, I'm able to predict something. And I say, OK, are you able to explain it? Because this is a very old debate between physicists and economists. Now I would like to, and this is the point, I would like to give you the contribution of econophysics by the point of view of economists. And I want to show you two quotations in order to illustrate the point of view. So the econophysics approach to economic theory has generally failed to produce models that are economically insightful. And another quotation. It looks like some econophysicists ignore decades of work in dozens of finance journals. Like, give the impression that what they attempt to do is the first quantitative analysis of finance. So at the end of the day, that's why I'm interested in the topic. Because economists, they say that, okay, look, we are doing what you try to do. So nothing new. But yes, we have some stuff new. So that's interesting to ask the question, why we have a difficulty of dialogue between these two communities. And why? Well, for three reasons. First of all, it's related to sociology of science. I don't want to be totally boring, but very quickly. The fact that physicists and financial economists, they have a different disciplinary matrix. They think the world in a different way, of course. It's related to the background. It's related to the concepts, theories. And if we use an anthropological point of view, we could say that it's like scientific tribes. They work on the same data, but they have different name, a different territory, and sometimes they have a kind of hostility. Not all the time. It's important to mention here that we can find collaborations and very good collaboration between economists and physicists, of course. But it's not the majority of the literature. But we can find. Hopefully and fortunately, we can find. But here I'm just talking about, generally speaking, it's not really the case. If we take the literature, because this is what I try to do with a bibliometric analysis in order to capture the speech, I mean the words, and how they talk about each other and this kind of stuff. So, and that's interesting to see that there is a kind of hostility. Not all the time, but in the literature. So, and if I give you an example here, it's interesting to see that sometimes I have the feeling, I don't know, it's just a personal feeling, but sometimes I have the feeling that they don't try, they even don't try to talk each other. In a sense that financial economists say, okay, we did it before, so nothing new. Using statistics in order to describe data, it's a very old story in finance. That's true. And because of that, they are not interesting in physics. And moreover, they say, yeah, you know, it's just a phenomenological approach. So that means that there is no theoretical justifications of that. But actually, it's not true in the sense that econophysics, they have a very strong theoretical, they have a very strong theoretical foundations. But the point is that physicists, they do not explain these theoretical foundations in their articles. That's why I decided to do the book Econophysics for a Financial Economist, in order to explain in details what are the foundations of the theoretical foundations of econophysics, statistical econophysics based on self-criticality and this kind of stuff. And what could be the economic translation of that? Because most of the time, physicists, they publish the article, they explain what they have to explain, but they forgot to explain the basic. And then people in economics, they say, what's this? I don't understand. There is no link with what I'm doing. So it's very interesting that it's a matter of language between and also a matter of convention between the two disciplines. And if we have a look on econophysicists, of course, as you can guess here, I took a telling illustration. It's not all the time. I mean, all econophysicists are not like that, and all financial economists are not like that, okay? Some people are more open-minded with the idea to work together or to collaborate. But I think it's a good example because it's a published paper here. Like, econophysicists are safer to ignore the lessons taught in standard economics. So that's very interesting. It looks like I don't want to talk with you. So, because I could be influenced by that. So, but if you are working on the same kind of reality with the same kind of tools, how it's possible not to talk together? How it's possible maybe to develop a common framework? This is the kind of question I'm working on. And then the second reason for why it's very difficult to combine econophysics with financial economics is the fact that I told you that econophysicists, what they want to do, I mean, originally, statistical econophysics, what they want to do is to describe the evolution of financial markets and the occurrence of extreme value through statistical patterns, macro patterns. Because they will say a micro level is very complex, so we will focus only on the phenomenological macro perspective. Okay, that's good. And most of the time they use power laws, as I've mentioned. However, we don't have a model in order to explain the emergence of power law. We can explain the emergence of power law by using a statistical and technical justification. It's a very old story. Yes, indeed, that because we can have a power law because it's related to the growth rate, blah, blah, blah. It's a technical explanation. It's not an economic explanation. It's not an explanation in terms of behavior, in terms of what people think, what how they behave in the reality in society. It's just a technical explanation. It's not enough in order to do something in economics. We can explain, and that's a very interesting, I think this is a very, very good example. Power law would come from the, would be the result of the heterogeneity of agent size, which could be characterized by a power law. But here you explain a power law by a power law. So that's interesting. But it looks like you try to avoid a little bit the problem, but that's very interesting, and the paper is very good, very strong. However, I'm not convinced by explaining a power law by a power law. So that's the point. And another point here is, okay, the power law would be the expression of the self-criticality theory. This is the theoretical foundations of econophysics. But most of the time, it's very difficult to understand or to read it for people who are in economics, because we don't understand. We are not physicists, and they are talking about concepts very complex and very abstract, and we don't understand exactly. So it's not an economic explanation. It's a physical explanation. So that's, at the end of the day, we don't know why we have a power law, why we have this kind of macro patterns on financial markets. Why? In economic term. It looks like in the literature, we didn't find a model explaining the emergence of power laws or macro statistical patterns. We don't have. So that's a reason for why it's difficult then to combine econophysics, because they have an output, the macro statistical patterns, but they will not give an economic explanation to that. And this is what we need as economists. And the last reason related to the fact that it's difficult to combine econophysics with economics is the fact that we don't have no Gaussian statistical test in order to validate the emergence of power law. Usually, when we check the literature related to econophysics, we can see that it is common for econophysicists to use a visual inspection of the data. So that means authors, they plot the data in a double logarithmic scale, and they will try to see if it fits the data. And they will say, look, we are using a lot of data, so we can trust this way of doing science. And in finance, we don't like it, for sure, for historical reasons that I plan to mention just after. First of all, we use this use of visual method can We are not sure that we have a specific power law because it could be an exponential, blah, blah, blah. So that means that you can have a mistake because it's related to an appreciation of a visual graph. And the other point is the fact that in finance, I was talking with a physicist who is used to implement this kind of visual method. And he said, why it's not trustable to do that? In finance, as you know, at the origin of finance in the 60s, when finance became a scientific discipline, they were fighting against Chartists. And they were justifying their knowledge by using statistical tests by contrast with Chartists. And they say, this is just visual stuff. You cannot do something with that. Even if Chartists, they say that, well, look, we have a lot of data and we can observe this. And they say, no, it's just superstition. Patterns described visually by some market analysis are just superstitions. So there is an historical reason for why in finance we don't like visual analysis of data. And I know that there is an emerging literature related to the fact that we need statistical tools in order to validate the emergence of power law. We can use some approximation by the rank, size, blah, blah, blah. We can, but we don't have a statistical test, which would give you the opportunity to compare empirical results given by econophysicists with empirical results given by financial economists. You can do it, and most of the time they love to play each other by saying that, well, what you are doing, I can do it, and so on. But if you check carefully the box they are using, we don't have the tools in order to compare. We have the same data, but we don't have the tools in order to validate the statistical significance of this comparison. So that means at the end of the day, we are in total incommensurability of knowledge. And there is a need for that. And if you check in statistics literature, there is a need of that. I mean, there is a lack in statistics about that. Some statisticians could talk about that. And finally, this is the conclusion. I think I was maybe long. Sorry for that. Didn't pay attention. You should tell me. Anyway, but sorry. But very quickly then, is econophysics the future of economics? Not for tomorrow, I think. Simply because even if we can find a lot of collaborations between economists and econophysicists, it's a multidisciplinary approach most of the time. They give their perspective and that's all. They don't try to develop a common framework which would transcend the theoretical constraints related to the disciplines. So they don't try to build something in common. I mean, a common framework which would make sense for both communities. I didn't find that in the literature because we don't know. And it's interesting to see that econophysicists, they say that, you don't try to describe the market as it is. So you are not data-oriented, data-driven. And I love this sentence, tenacity of theory against empirical evidence would be an argument for rather than against regarding it as a scientific. In a sense that financial economists, they are ready to change their framework, their paradigm, only if they have something better in terms of economic terms, in terms of explanation. So this is the first reason for why it's not for tomorrow that we will have a common framework between econophysics and economics, financial economics, I mean, and the creation of statistical tests in order to validate or not the existence of power law and the statistical significance of comparison between these two frameworks. And finally, creation of a generative model explaining the emergence of power law. This is the three points which should be in the research agenda if we want one day to have a common framework between financial economics and, I mean, mainstream, and mainstream statistical econophysics, I mean, dealing with statistical patterns. So thank you very much for your attention, and sorry because I didn't pay attention.
So if you just put your hands up, if you've got some questions, we'll kind of pre-take them as a group, if that's okay, and then I'll turn them together. So,
right at the back. Sorry, for a second, speaker. So I was wondering, when you're saying that fiscal models can't explain financial crisis or financial, basically, variations in the markets, is it because they're mostly determined by quirky events, say, I had a safe dying or something else, rather than having a real, say, being a real critical phenomenon, as a physicist would say, is if you're referring to those models. Because if you're talking about, say, a country, I don't know, having too many rich people and therefore having a transition to something else, I mean, that's a lot like the desertification of, or cancer prediction. You can basically predict the state of a cancer based on its geometrical properties, and you know this cancer is going to blow up completely, like you're saying, if you add one grain of salt more, like if you infect one more cell. So are you saying that econophysics is not good enough because of these events, or is it just a failure in the method? What do you think on this?
We just got more then. Sorry, I think we have one slide as well.
Sorry.
So I want to ask about the prospect of using the Google keywords to predict the financial market. So if suppose all the investment bank in the world use your technique and they try to research for new keywords to use from time to time if one fails, so would you think that the keywords will lose their predictive power? And if the ups and downs of the financial market are so dominated by the algorithms, so would you think that the movement in the financial market will be so unintelligible to small investor that the financial news will just lose their values in informing the investor what to do?
Well, thank you for your question. I didn't say that econophysics is not good enough or something like that. I just said that given their way of thinking and describing the world, I mean statistical econophysics, they don't give an economic meaning to the crash or to the critical perspective. However, I would like to mention, I didn't talk about it, but and you worked on that, I know that, the link between agent-based modeling and statistical patterns, in the sense that you have a statistical patterns, you will use some statistical constraint in order to define some micro-interaction, which would be economic, which would have a meaning from an economic point of view, in order to find the micro-patterns. In that way, that would be possible then. But I didn't mention that because it's a very new way of doing, and I know that you are working on this kind of stuff. So it's just not economic meaning. This is what I want to say.
Okay, just to pick up this point, I mean, you are completely right, and that's this might actually be one promising bridge for the near future between understanding the micro-level dynamics and then what actually on the macroscopic scale happens. I mean, this agent-based models, this also goes back now for quite a while. The real difference it makes now is that with an increasing amount of computing power available, actually the number of agents being modeled increased vastly over the last few years. And so there are actually a few multidisciplinary groups involving physicists and economists looking at exactly this interdisciplinary gap and then looking at using a large amount of agents for their systems, but also making use of the fact that more and more basically what I tried to touch on, more micro-level data on these individual agents is available nowadays to actually give these agents a realistic starting conditions in this modeling framework. To your question, I mean, obviously I'm not claiming that this is something which should work tomorrow. Please don't leave this lecture theater and then start a trade based on how many people are going to be dead. Probably this would be the completely wrong way. I mean, any kind of statistical pattern you find in the market context, obviously, as soon as this gets revealed, and if it is something which is stable over time, as soon as people use it, obviously, through statistical arbitrage, this will vanish over time and maybe, hopefully, make markets more efficient. Actually, interestingly, I mean, given this very simple model or trading strategy I described, is we looked in a number of papers throughout several years into the relationship between the strategy and how this works in several or in different markets around the globe. And actually what we find is that in recent years, so after lots of people actually had the chance to at least look at this, we are not claiming that this is a causal relationship, because lots of people actually looked into this strategy that stopped to work, but actually the profitability over time goes down. So in the early years when we actually looked at individual years separately, we found all of these years showed significant behavior. And this actually is something which changed over time. we have to acknowledge it's a very, very simple strategy. So I wouldn't actually go into the direction that maybe it comes completely useless at some point, because I mean, we as humans, obviously, the markets are not disconnected from what is going on in the world, and then so forth. All of we as humans are interested in. And given the broadness of search volume, for example, so what we are interested in as humans on an ongoing basis around the globe, maybe more complex and more sophisticated strategies taking into account might actually be able to be successful. And a final comment on this question, there are also different other pathways where you can actually try and restrict the type of search volume or level of information gathering in a way that you're not looking at an entire population, for example, data which is captured by Google, for example, but looking at in a more sophisticated way at platforms which are only accessible or frequently used by people very close to the financial markets, like traders interacting with a Bloomberg terminal. You basically can ask or start and ask the question to which extent the usage of this Bloomberg terminal and searches carried out within the system might actually show some similar patterns or something which can be used over time.
Do you have any more questions? Two at the front. So, John, you're first.
So I'm trying to understand what the physics is in econophysics. And so far I've taken away one thing, which is that econophysicians they have the philosophical stance that they're trying to just model the data rather than figure out the micro foundations of it. Other than that, is there anything that's particularly physics-y about it? For instance, the methods they're using or what kinds of models?
And then the person behind you?
Yeah, I guess kind of similar question. Given that you don't have specific models for the patterns emerging, what does that say about the predictive powers of quantum physics and what happens when, say, parameters change and what happens to coefficients then? Do you have any sort of, do you know what happens? Does it go up with up or down with up? Or
well, maybe I can begin and you will complete. The point is that, yes, econophysicists, they have strong theoretical foundations and tools, and but most of the time, coming from physics, I mean, like I've mentioned quickly, the self-criticality and this kind of stuff, that's interesting, but most of the time in their papers, because they publish in physics journal, they don't have to remind the basics information. And when you are not physicist and you are economist and you want to understand what they are doing, you read the paper and you have the feeling that, okay, it's like it's a little bit, you know, rough, and it's just we have the feeling that there is no. It's difficult to give an economic meaning to that, but from a physical point of view, of course, yes, they have foundations, theoretical foundations, and probably you can give more information than me because you are a physicist, so for sure. And in terms of prediction, very quickly, the point is that. Yes, they have good results in terms of predictions. I mean, I was thinking about Sornet. I mentioned Sornet and the crash. He has very good tools in order to give predictions. But that's why I use the question marks in the slides. This is a very old debate about predictions and explanation. And this is, you know, Friedman in economics. What you will predict, are you able to explain? Well, it's a very old debate. But they have good results, yes.
So your first point is right. As maybe there is a different way how physicists think about the world and how they make progress in terms of building equations, models on about how the world might work. And this is actually in the first instance a very data-driven effort. I mean, if you look back centuries, basically physicists started to carry out experiments to collect data to actually come up with laws, natural laws about how the world works. And actually one fundamental difference to some human behavioral types of phenomena is actually that these natural laws do not necessarily change over time. So obviously these are testable laws where you can carry out the same experiment and within statistical fluctuations you get the same results, same parameters. It's something within a financial or behavioral context is not necessarily the case. So for example, the last example I gave about the flu, something about people searching for flu symptoms, that's something which might change when it's influenced by lots of external factors.
So you are asking, in as a second part of your question, what is actually the toolbox of war, what might be the theories, the underlying theories which physicists can bring to the table. And this, you covered this to some extent. basically, it's the idea of complexity science. So physicists historically developed a vast amount of tools in order to deal with atoms interacting with each other, so multi-body problems where you basically try to describe macroscopic features of, let's say, matter by using features at a microscopic level. And so there were lots of different models for this developed. So one famous model for ferromagnetism, for example, is called
Ising model. I'm not sure who is familiar with that. And that's something, it's a model where you, a very simple model where you have a lattice-based structure and at each side you have individual spins which can take on a certain number of states, in the simplest version two states, spin up and spin down. And that's something which helps you to explain certain phenomena in the world, in matter, but that's also a model, a very simple model which was taken from physics in order to explain all sorts of social and also financial phenomena. If you think about traders interacting with each other in the markets, I mean, obviously it's not something that they would be put on the sides of an Ising lattice, but basically from an ideas point of view, where you basically, if you simulate this model, and also obviously in one and two dimensions, you can actually solve this analytically, then you find that the power law emerges from these interactions within this space, if you change temperatures and things like that. So these sorts of models developed from a large body of physics knowledge over centuries actually was used in order to use this in a different context where physicists started to identify, for example, interacting particles as actually interacting humans in whatever context, and actually try to use solutions developed for the physics case in order to come up with equivalents which might be useful for the social, for our world, how we interact with each other. And so in some cases, I mean, obviously, you are referring to the fact that some of the underlying models or underlying knowledge is not necessarily described in physics publications. But I would actually say that this is a very natural phenomenon if you look at the way how our scientific world is structured and basically the silo structure of all disciplinary differences. I mean, the same might maybe apply for lots of finance publications read by biologists and vice versa. So basically it's the interdisciplinary dialogue which is required, and luckily I know some examples of recent conferences where actually it is going to happen, where actually physicists and economists and people from this wider area are coming together, starting not only to talk, but also start to collaborate and develop joint projects and papers. And this might maybe in the near future the way forward. And from my point of view, I truly believe in interdisciplinarity, because actually to be challenged by someone from a different field, to take into account thoughts from someone else's data combined with a different method and domain expert knowledge which comes from somewhere completely else, might actually be really helpful and fruitful to have this discussion. And I hope this actually happens a lot and across many, many different disciplines, not only physics and finance. Mm-hmm.
I think there's Christophe and made one point, and then we have a good time.
Just quickly, I totally agree, but if I play the devil advocate, there are a lot of, there is a literature about analogy, because with Ising model, it's a matter of analogy. And if a model can explain everything, then what is the explanative power of this model? And this is, I mean, if you can use as an analogy for a lot of phenomena, what is specific to the explanation of this specific phenomenon? I mean, there is a huge literature related to that. I mean, I agree with what you say, but you know what I mean? Is the fact that the problem of analogy is a real question, the analogy. Can we use analogy? To what extent we can use the analogy? If we can use the same analogy everywhere, then what you will explain if this is the same explanation for everything? I mean, not for everything, but for large categories of phenomena.
I didn't say everything.
Yeah, no. I know, but just mention that.
Yeah, thank you everyone for staying so late. Let's give our speakers a big round of applause.